he said, you know, you are not your past. You are the lessons and the resources that you glean from it. And I remember that day, I realized like, no one's going to write me a permission slip. No one's going to come along and do that. I've got to write my own damn permission slip. You know, that's what I got to do for myself that day when I did that. And I noticed myself shift, and I gave myself permission to create and to go, I'm going to do something new here.
You're watching Young and Profiting Podcast on YouTube. Welcome to the show. I'm your host, Hala Taha, and on Young and Profiting Podcast, we investigate a new topic each week and interview some of the brightest minds in the world. Before we get started, hit the subscribe button and don't forget to click the bell icon to be notified every time we drop a new video.
Hey, Joel, welcome to Young and Profiting Podcast.
Hala, thank you so much for having me. Appreciate you inviting me on this show.
I'm so hyped for this conversation because when you speak from the heart and you're just so inspirational, so motivational. Everything that I've heard from you, I feel just so connected with you because I feel like we have very, very similar beliefs in terms of like how we attack becoming successful. And I think you're a little bit more planned in terms of like, this is what you do. You teach people how to be motivated, inspired. And I feel like everything you say, I'm like, yeah, that's what I do. But I just haven't like ever thought about it so clearly or written it down. So I'm really excited to talk to you. So you're an entrepreneur. You're a podcast host, you're many things, but we always like to start from the beginning. So from my understanding, in high school, you were bullied and you actually dropped out when you were 16. So talk to us about what you were like as a teenager and then how you ended up, you know, being inspired to go on this journey in terms of tackling your dreams and things like that.
Awesome. Well, that's a good place to start. Let's look at that. It's interesting because a lot of people will be like, when did you first build your website or when did you, you know, first make, you know, this much money? Or I honestly really believe that these type of moments shape your life. And for me, growing up in high school, the first couple years, I felt like I fit in. I felt like school was pretty normal. I was doing pretty well. And then there was this popular group, if you want to call it like that. I don't know, in America, you maybe call it like the jocks. Mm-hmm. Right. I started to kind of form this group together and they used to go around just picking on everybody, you know, the Asians, the Gothics, the nerds, just anyone that they could class as different to them. And I was learning capoeira, the Brazilian martial arts, and kickboxing at the time. You know, when I was a little kid, even in kindergarten, I remember having a bit of a run in and I felt like the injustice was not fair, you know, and so it's a double-edged sword. It's a gift and a curse in a sense that it's like it's a driver in me to notice things in the world where there is that injustice and to go, well, like, let's find a solution for this. On the other side, I got to make sure I don't consume myself in it because you can develop a savior complex, right? That was definitely a workings that I got to go through earlier on in my coaching career was making sure that I wasn't pouring out so much and getting so much meaning from being able to, you know, help everybody. Mm-hmm. Now I don't look at it like that. I don't help people. I support, you know, everyone has greatness in them. You've got greatness in you, right? And it's about inspiring and challenging you to shift your perceptions, to look at things in a different way. I can't tell you what to think, but I can challenge you and I can present to you different ways of thinking so that mm-hmm. how you think becomes different, right?
Yeah.
So that's what I, you know, from a young age, I went through that experience. I got very severely bullied from year 9 all the way up to year 11. So it was like 2.5 to 3 years just straight of just every recess and lunchtime, bullied. And one day I just went, enough, like me and you after school, let's do it. And the guy never showed up. And then 3 months later, I got a tap on the shoulder and got knuckle dusters to the face and got steel cap boots and jumped by 20 people.
Oh my gosh, you were 11?
No, it was year 11.
Year 11, so in Australia, okay, got it.
Yeah. Yeah, in Australia, it's 16 years old. So, you know, in Australia, we graduate high school at the end of our year of being 17. You know, mm-hmm. you start college or TAFE when you're 18. And I never graduated. I don't have a high school certificate. I dropped out. I'm a high school dropout. Yeah. So there was definitely something in me that I felt like I wasn't meant for school. Like I remember feeling so bored out of my brains when I'd sit there listening to my teacher teaching trigonometry and algebra.
Yeah.
You know, I could respect the fact that that was for somebody else in a different space. I was like, that's cool. But I just always felt really unstimulated. Like I wanted to create, I wanted to express. I loved like reading things and sharing things. And I think that, you know, a lot of the systems and structures in the world, until you actually start to really immerse yourself in new philosophies and new understandings, a lot of the time it's really like a factory. It's very rigid. It's a very rigid way of living life. And I think that it's not one size fits all. It's very general. And there is, I believe we live in some sort of a matrix where we do have structures in our life that are, to a degree, favor the general masses. But I think a lot of people that want to be able to actually do something pretty wild in this world, they're going to have to be ready to be ridiculed and be ready to be told that what they want to do is not going to work. And it's just people's small-minded visions that they're projecting on you. And if you don't have a grand vision for your future and you're not committed to it, you're not in the practice of stepping in, then you buy into their small-minded visions that they project on you.
Yeah. And I'm definitely going to touch on visions in a moment. But first, I want to keep talking about your journey. And by the way, for everybody listening, me and Joel have very similar journeys and we've done a lot of the same things. So talk to us about how you got into the music career, because from my understanding, you know, you're a high school dropout, but then you had a very successful music career and even I think dabbled in radio at one point. So I'd love to hear about how you got those opportunities when you actually didn't have the credentials. So how did that happen?
Great question. Yeah. Yes. Oh man, you're taking my mind back. This is awesome, Hala. I love it. So I was very much into my hip hop and R&B. That was my jam. I used to listen to, what was I listening to? DMX, It's Dark and Hell Is Hot. I used to listen to, you know, Dr. Dre, Chronic 2001. When I was in high school, before I dropped out, I remember 50 Cent had come out, Get Rich or Die Trying. It was like a big classic album. And so I was, you know, very much in that space. I practiced producing music. I DJ. But what I was really good at, just, you know, when you look back in your life and you kind of challenge yourself, and I challenge anyone that's listening right now, like look back and have a look at the pinnacle moments in your life where you had like great achievements or breakthroughs. What skill set were you using often? What was that consistent skill set that you brought in? For me, when I looked back at it in retrospect, I realized the power of networking. You know, I have had this knack that I had developed where I was very dialed into being able to pretty much create opportunities for anyone I was connected with, right? Like I'd just be able to like look at a situation and go, there's a way to create a win-win in this. And this is how you're able to bring value to a person in this way. And if I was able to bring this person in, or I was able to utilize whatever this is in my platform, that we'd be able to create a win-win situation. And I just got really good at identifying that. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of it comes down to, you know, I had a conversation with Dr. Joe Dispenza and we talked about this, right? And he said, Joel, you know, I think one of our greatest weaknesses in humanity is the fact that we're just poor observers. And I just remember I'd observe a lot, right? Like I kind of like notice what was happening in the scape and I would then go and utilize that, and that would become my strength. So I started using that when it came to music, and I started noticing talent, you know, DJs that were good, producers that were good, songwriters that were good. And I'd like pair them together and we create demo tracks, and then I would utilize, I was using MySpace. Right? I created a website called stadiummusic.net. You probably can't even find it anymore. I don't know if it's even around. Stadiummusic.net. It was a mixtape website. Mm-hmm. It was a hip hop and R&B mixtape. And I was very much, I connected with a guy called DJ Clinton Sparks. I don't know if I think he's on,
I've heard of him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sirius Satellite Radio, I think. Yeah. So I know you were in Hot 97. And so, you know, I saw a lot of inspiration in him. I got to connect with him when he came out to Australia. And, you know, I was selling mixtapes at the time, ordering him into Australia and then selling him off. I don't think I've ever shared this on any interview. You get an exclusive right now. Look out. And it just kind of like went from like a leverage point to a leverage point, where because I had these mixtapes, other artists and people wanted to get on to being able to be a part of what I was putting out and distributing. And then on top of that, I was using MySpace to reach out to artists, people like Fat Joe, Talib Kweli, Pitbull, T-Pain, these type of artists, to get them on a radio station in Perth in Western Australia. And see, I don't even have the radio station. I volunteered to see if I could produce. And I just kept showing up. I kept knocking on the door. I went every single week. My dad used to drop me off because I hadn't got my license yet, right? I was getting my P-plates, training for my license. But I would show up every week consistently and just keep knocking and keep asking. And finally, they said, look, you can sit in with the producer and just kind of see how it all works. And that was when I met a DJ that was there. His name's DJ Fanatic, which is, we'll fast forward it soon and you'll see who he is. It's pretty interesting. And what I did was I thought, man, there's a way I can bring value to this to really start like moving up the ranks. So I would jump on MySpace and I'd reach out to these artists and I'd say, hey, I can get you plays on Western Australia's biggest hip hop and R&B station if we do an interview. So I used to get like, this was before just remember this, like this is getting resourceful here, Ala. Like it's another thing for anyone that's listening, like what resources can you use? Get resourceful, like look around, find out what tools you can use to make it happen, right? So I would get an old school telephone, you know, like the ones where you have to like pick it up and it's got a cord. I had one of those, right? And I'd run a really long, like 12 meter, 15 meter cable out into the kitchen in my parents' house. And I would buy a international dialing card and it would cost a lot. Like if I was on an hour conversation, that was like a $10 card to call America from Australia, but I would do it and I'd patch it into a microphone, into a mixer, and then would run that into my computer, into my sound card. And I used to record through some program. I think it was like Go Wave or it was some sort of program. Mm-hmm. And I would be interviewing these artists. And then what I'd do is I'd get exclusive tracks from them and I would have their interviews wedged in between the exclusive tracks. Plus I'd like get more exclusive mixtape stuff from other artists that wanted to feature it, and we'd play it as like a mix on the radio show.
Mm.
And I got into a conversation with T-Pain's manager, and he was linked with a guy called Jim Johnson. Now, Jim Johnson produced Lollipop for Lil Wayne. He produced T.I., Whatever You Like, Soulja Boy, Kiss You Through Huge. The Phone, Sweet Dreams for Beyonce. Yeah, he had so many tracks, right? And he was looking for some apprentice producers at the time. He's like, I want to like build out my production team. So my buddy, DJ Fanatic, who was a Scratch Battle DMC champion, DJ, I linked him with a guy that could play piano and was an audio engineer. So they came together to make awesome music, scratch up samples and play keys over the top. And Jim Johnson loved it so much that he flew us all out to Miami. Mm. So that's kind of where it all started. And we signed a subsidiary deal under Atlantic Records. Then we're working in the studio, meeting people like Usher and Pharrell. And we worked with the Evanescence piano players. And we worked with the guys that did all the violins for Linkin Park and, you know, Nelly and Kelly Rowland and Ludacris. And as a matter of fact, you know, my producers at the time, Fnatic and Zach, now they produced a bunch of tracks for Kanye West. They produced A$AP Rocky's tracks. You know, they've worked with a lot of awesome artists, and they've just been doing that this whole time. They've been staying in and committed. Mm-hmm. But at one point, I'm going to be honest with you, Hala, I started to feel like I would wake up every morning. This is about 3 years in, after all like the awesome, you know, red carpet events and hanging out with all the, you know, the celebs and stars. Mm-hmm. And I used to wake up every morning with this knot in my stomach.
Yeah.
And this like looping line in my head of, I'm not supposed to be here. And yeah. I couldn't understand it. I couldn't understand it at the start. I was like, what? Like, am I being ungrateful? Am I in fear? And it wasn't. It was love. It was like, I'm passionate about life and I know there's more in me. And it was really hard for my producers at the time to understand that when I told them I'm not going to continue on the journey. They were like, and people thought I was crazy. Like, yeah. I had friends, family, people were like, why would you do this? Why would you throw it in? I'm like, I think in our life, we're supposed to have multiple passions. Some of us have the bandwidth for that. And I said, I'm just ready to go to another chapter I need the next challenge.
Yeah.
And I know
hold that.
More
hold
in
that. Yeah. Hold that thought for a second. We're going to get there. I love this transition, but I do want to talk about networking because you brought up something so key that I just want to drill home. And I'm very, very similar. Networking is bringing people it's just connecting dots. And that's the best way to maintain relationships. When you can be like, I know this person, I know that person, they need to know each other and do something together. And that's such a great way to like keep your connections warm and keep in touch with people and make yourself relevant and make yourself valuable. Because then the next time somebody has an opportunity, they're going to think of you because they're, oh yeah, Hala hooked me up with this. Let me call her. That's like a master networking technique. So talk to us about that a little bit in terms of like in that space, what have you learned in terms of like your top tips for networking before we get on to next chapter of your life?
That's a great question. You know, I think from a psychological standpoint, like let's go there. I don't think I ever looked at it in a way where, oh, I want to hook that person up. So it's a win for me. It was always about the excitement of creating something more than what was already in reality. Like I love that. I'm a creator at heart. Like I love creating content online. I love creating things for my coaches. I love creating new frameworks and coaching tools. I just love it. I love the challenge that like no one's created it in this way. I want to create this. And maybe that's why I had an affinity for music, you know, is I really appreciate creation. And for me, I always looked at it like, you know, if I could come in and share ideas, and those ideas were able to be like, we do it every time when we create events and workshops and retreats. You know, when I work with my speakers and my business partners that I've worked with before, it's like, we've got an idea. Okay, this is how the event will go. And it's crazy. And I say it sometimes, like I'm standing on stage and we've got all these people in the audience. And I tell them like, you guys, this was just an idea. Like months ago, this was just an idea. And now we're all sitting in the idea right now. Like this is manifested in reality. And it's so gangster. It's so cool. Like that's what I want people to be able to know, that they're able to do this too. And that's the fun thing about success. For me, it's not about the bling bling, the material. It's actually being able to manifest what started here and has become reality, knowing that, man, I'm powerful in my creation. Yeah. I'm a weapon of mass creation, you know? And unfortunately, people stay in stagnation because they're not tapping into that incredible weapon of beauty and love that they can share with the world. And so for me, I look at it like, man, if I can just show someone that like creation is possible, and that I always say this to people, especially when I'm doing sales, right? Like if I'm having a conversation with someone and they're looking at coming in on a program, or they just feel stuck and they you know, they're coming up with some reasons as to why they can't afford or invest. I ask them, I go, look, if you were to challenge yourself with this question, I want you to really think about this. Ask yourself this: what must I create in order to make this possible? And I leave them with that. I'm like, you go work out whatever that is. You know, I'm not a person that's going to say, go get your credit card, go get a loan, go get. Yep. I just say, just walk away with this one question that you ask yourself, and then just let me know in 24 hours. And I can't tell you how many times other people have come back to me to go, Joel, like I found a way. And I'm like, of course you have, because there always was a way. Yep. It was a matter of resourcefulness and willingness. Like, are you ready? Yep. Are you actually really, how bad do you want it? Are you willing to play all out, even if you don't know what's coming next? Because what's coming next is going to be greater than what you've ever achieved. That's a beautiful thing about our future, is that it hasn't, like our past has nothing on what we can create now. There's more to come.
Yeah. And I love what, like when you're talking about being resourceful and kind of using your leverage, it's something that I talk about a lot. You need to kind of take an inventory and see, like, what do you actually have? Like, what connections do you have? What platforms do you have? Like, what are your resources? A lot of people kind of fall to the excuse instead of thinking about like creative solutions for how you can get what you want, right? I think really a lot of success is about having these creative solutions and just asking, you know? So I totally agree with everything you're saying.
A thousand percent. You get it. You just hit the nail on the head. And this is a word of wisdom that I live by. I remember when I first heard this, I just went, wow. Like it just resonated in everything in my being, and I've embraced it ever since. And it is, you don't get in life what you think you deserve. You get what you negotiate. Everything's a negotiation. That. Like it's not even just what you say, Hala. Right, if you're listening now, I want you to really challenge yourself. Have I just been saying things, or am I actually doing it through my actions too? Because we negotiate through the way that we show up in how we be as well.
Really cool. Yeah. I love that. Let's talk about negotiation later. And I want to talk about your next phase in life. So you were just talking about how you were in music and you decided that this wasn't really fulfilling for you anymore. And what happened? You went back to Australia after that? What happened next?
I went back to Australia. You know, there was like this instilled belief within me. I call it the whispers of wisdom, right? It was like God was tapping me on the shoulder, and he's like, and I remember just feeling these times where I noticed that I started to feel like I had a hunger and a thirst to go into more self-development. And I didn't quite work out like what I was going to do with it. I took up a sales job. I started reading Grant Cardone's sales book, Closer's Survival Guide. I think it was Closer's Sales Survival Guide. One of those books, reading Stephen Covey, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. I was listening to Jack Canfield. I was listening to Les Brown. And I started to feel within myself like, hey, it'd be really cool to be able to do this, you know, to be able to speak and to inspire others. I think it's what I was trying to do in the space I was in. But as a manager with producers and songwriters, I was in the background, you know? And I was like, man, I could do more with this. I want to actually be with people. I want to talk with people. I want to hear people's stories, you know? I got really good at my sales, and I got really good at applying a lot of the habits to my life. You know, I started living in what I call the 4 dimensions of excellence: values, beliefs, habits, and skills, right? Which is your values is your compass. Your beliefs is you got to be ready. your habits is, are you willing, and your skills is, are you able, right? And so I really just started living in this space where I committed myself to sticking to frameworks and really seeing like, hey, what would I do if I played at my highest level, you know, more consistently. And I did really well, and I worked my way up the rungs in the sales company, and I had the opportunity to sit in a room in a sales environment. It was a training workshop. This guy walks out, you know, he has this white button-up shirt. It is, you know, like these shiny little cufflinks. He had a Rolex watch. He had these shiny shoes and slack pants. He's like, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jordan Belfort and the Wolf of Wall Street. And I'm here today to teach you how to be a force to be reckoned with. I don't know if I got the jersey yet.
I think he's New York. Yeah. Maybe he's Jersey.
Yeah. I think he's New York. I think he's from New York. I just remember feeling like, wow, like I'm blown away. This dude is an actual live speaker in the flesh. I listened to Tony Robbins and these people, but I sat right at the front and he was there and he challenged me. So he challenged everyone in the room to cast a 10-year vision, but he turned to me and he challenged me to get up and command it to the room, declare the vision. And you know, I got the CEO of the company that expects me to go under the wing of the manager of the company to like work my way up. And the manager was like, you're going to be here. And kind of like, oh, this will be yours. You know, looking out of the ivory tower, like the city, and like they're all buying Aston Martins there. And it was kind of like the boys club. And I was like, okay, I got to work my way up to that. But once I was in the room that day and I actually was challenged to write out what I truly want to do, and I got clear. And at the start, I'm going to be honest with you, it was kind of uncomfortable. It was like, you know, my limiting beliefs were in the way and all this stuff. But I was like writing it out and I felt excited. And then I read it out. And I remember the CEO in the back of the room was just like, what the? Like you could see him like kind of cursing to himself and he's shaking his head. He couldn't believe the declaration I was making, because I was basically saying, I'm going to leave this job and I'm going to be running this big self-development company. And they're all kind of like, well, are you going to put resources into this kid? You know, this 21-year-old kid, you know, that's, or 22-year-old kid that's saying that he's going to be, you know, using all his time to build this out. And I ended up wrapping up pretty shortly after that. And crazy story, I ended up working up north in the deserts of Western Australia, catching snakes and lizards and kangaroos. Sounds kind of out there, but I did that because in my vision, I mapped out this like one big swing. It's like, what would you do in your 10-year vision? When I was reverse engineering it, it was like, if I was to make this 10-year vision a 2-year vision or a 3-year vision, like what would be the one big like outlandish swing that you would do that would like catapult you closer to that 10th year? And for me, it was leaving the day job that I was in to earn double the money so that I can invest even more faster back into build addicted to success. And it was like putting me in prison, seriously, because it was like 12-hour days. In America, you'd say it'd be like 120 degree Fahrenheit heat. You know, like 28 days straight with only like a full 4 days off, you know, so it was intense. But the whole time I was just like listening to Think and Grow Rich. I was just listening to Tony Robbins. I was just centering on my vision the whole time. Like it's going to this. I'm building it out. It's going to happen.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. That's such an inspiring story. I love this. So 10-year vision, talk to us about, like, if you can just give us a guide in terms of how do we create our 10-year vision? What is the relationship of goals within that vision? And from my understanding, you actually accomplished your 10-year vision in 6 years. So you just talked about the swing. Is there any other tips in terms of how we can accelerate that?
Yeah. You know, I've been teaching the 10-year vision process for a long time now, and I was blessed by Jordan because he introduced me to the concept of it. He essentially said, you know, write out a script with as much detail. There's a few things he taught me in there, like some words of wisdom. He said, and I remember this because I felt a bit of a block while I was writing out my vision. I felt like I was dark. I felt like I had done things in my past. You know, I got into drugs and alcohol and you know, like sexually deviant. And like I was beating myself up for it, right? I was like acting as if like, you know, I'd made all these mistakes and I wasn't worthy of being a positive, inspiring person. Like what if, you know, the imposter syndrome, what if I get caught out? What if people think that I'm not positive and I've done all these things when I was younger, you know? And he said, you know, you are not your past. You are the lessons and the resources that you glean from it. And I remember that day I realized like no one's going to write me a permission slip. No one's going to come along and do that. I've got to write my own damn permission slip. You know, that's what I got to do for myself that day when I did that. And I noticed myself shift and I gave myself permission to create and to go, I'm going to do something new here. And so that was a really defining moment for me. And I think for anybody, when you give yourself permission to just do something different for once, you know, it's like, you're going to wait to feel worthy, or do you negotiate it, right? The same thing as what I said, like when you say like, just because you think you deserve it, that's not enough. It's part of it, but it's not enough. I've got to show that I'm willing to step in and do it anyway. I want it anyhow, no matter what the cause, like I'm there, you know, and I keep showing up in it consistently. And so he taught me this concept just by just dropping that word of wisdom, and I pieced it together. And he shared to reverse engineer it. Start with the 10th year. What would you do in the ninth year to get to the 10th, the 8th to get to the 9th, and like write it back. I wrote so many pages, like 16 or 17 pages.
Wow.
But you know, the thing that I've come to realize just through really just going around, traveling around the world, teaching this to tens of thousands of people, I actually tweaked it a lot, and I added in my own frameworks and other things to just really supercharge the vision process. The one thing I'd say, Hala, like if you really keep this in mind, it's not even about you achieving the vision. It's not about the things that you get in the vision. It's about who you become in the process, right? Like when I write something down, and when you write something down and you follow through, you're a woman of your word. I'm a man of my word. That in itself is worth its weight in gold. Like to be somebody that writes something down and shows up and follows through, that's an incredible skill set to have, because a lot of people don't take ownership. Mm-hmm. It's a huge thing. I do a lot of trauma work, right? So we do a lot of work around healing, and a lot of people don't take ownership for their wounds because it's easy to blame somebody else. If I'm getting triggered, it's them. It's not me. It's them. Well, guess what? You'll never change because you're not like it starts with you.
Yeah.
And when you start to, you know, go into this and realize, wait, I get to actually create what I want in my life. And I believe that you get to have it all, just not all at once. It comes together in time, and you have patience. And that's why with the 10-year vision process, I go through the 8 categories of life. And then you map out the vision based off your 8 categories to have the most harmonious life, right? Because I believe everything is touching everything. So you have one, I'll break down the categories for you if you don't mind.
Yeah.
We have, write this down if you're listening right now. We've got business and career. Okay, that's the first one. Second is finances. Third is health. Really important, especially right now, right? Fourth one is romance, right? That might be a bit of a trigger for some people too. Romance, right? Then we have family and friends. Then we have fun and adventure. Then we have self-development. And for some of you, it may be spiritual development, depending on how you feel yourself. And then the last one is physical environment, right? And this is one that a lot of people miss. It's like, do you actually feel inspired where you live? Do you have natural light coming in? Are you close to the places where you want to be? Do you have to, like, you know, commute like I used to when I was working a 9-to-5 job for 1 hour there to work, 1 hour back, and I started crunching the numbers. It's like 2 hours a day, 10 hours a week, 40 hours a month, 470 something hours a year. I felt like I was wasting my life. You know, so like all these things are important, because we even consider physical environment. Our physical environment has a 40% effect on our mental state. If you stay in an environment long enough, over a longer period of time, in the matter of weeks to months, it's going to have an effect on your mental state. Like right now, there's a war on reality with COVID and everything that's going on. And like, whether you like it or not, something's changed in the atmosphere. So, you know, it's about like, well, how do I structure my life in a way where it sets me up to win? Even if these things are happening, like I'm not going to be blind to it and ignorant, but I'm going to structure so that I'm doing more of what I desire, that I value in my day, because that's where I'm in spirit. That's where I'm inspired from within. You don't need to motivate yourself anymore. Motivation's on the external. I want internal. I want in spirit. I want inspiration. I want to have the torch lit from within and be creating what I desire to create in my life, not what society tells me I should do, not what mom and dad think is a great idea, you know, not what my best friend will drop in every now and then, and, you know, in a conversation of like, you should do this and that. If it's not in alignment with what I truly value, then no, you don't. Because a lot of people will often do things to be able to get significance and validation and approval from others. It's very liberating when you create from a place where you realize you don't have to do that anymore, that you're actually, you can accept who you are yourself, and you can create what you want yourself.
Yeah.
And you can be a good human in the process too. I think some people think they got to sacrifice, oh, I've got to be this type of person in order to get this. You don't.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. You guys need to like rewind that part back, because he just dropped so many gems. Let's stick on motivation versus inspiration? Because I know that they're two very different things. Talk mm-hmm. to us about that and why we kind of need to focus on inspiration and how we can do that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the reason why I'm not the biggest fan of motivation is because it almost damn near killed me, right? And I mean that in a sense that it almost killed my flow and it killed my dreams. I started to lose myself in the game. I call it the game. Because there's a game that's going on right now and a lot of people are caught up in it. We see it on social media. You know, people are, they're acting in a certain way to mm-hmm. be able to be popularized, mm-hmm. To be able to be accepted, to be validated. Now, that's coming from lack and scarcity and it's filling a void, essentially. But the problem with it is that it becomes this like vacuum, right? And it's just never enough. And so I did this for so long. I mean, even the name Addicted to Success, I'm going to be honest with you. I was creating from that place when I created it. Now I can embrace it and like kind of be like, hey, cool, that was my journey and that's what it is. And it still applies today. It's just my definitions of success changed. Mm. You know, because some people will go, well, success to me is getting a bunch of money. It's about having the status and the significance and it's having the fancy house on the hill and it's having the awesome network of like people that respect me because I'm doing great things. But the question is, can you go to bed at night feeling good about who you are as a human being, right? Mm-hmm. Do you go to bed at night crying yourself to sleep? Are you proud of the type of relationships that you can have in your life? Or do you just, you ruin each one that you step into? Or are you attracting ones you don't want in your life, right? Because these are the things that matter more. I know this, but it's like, I had to achieve a lot of things to realize like the things, the material is not it. It's how I feel about who I am and it's how I feel about my mission. Is it meaningful? Is it actually something that I'm proud of that I can get up and go, you know what? Moving the needle today. And I'm surrounded by people that also have great virtues in their life and they're great people. Like some of my friends, they don't have big businesses. They don't have, you know, the money coming in and all the other. They're just really good people and I trust them. And they really stand by their integrity and they have great loyalty and they're very compassionate. Like that, to me, that's way more valuable than somebody that has a verification badge on their mm-hmm. profile or that's made 20 million. I've hung out with centillionaires and some of them, I'm just not impressed. I just wouldn't hang out with them. It doesn't matter who they are, what they have. And I think a lot of people hang so much of like an emphasis on things that are so shallow and so surface. And I think to some degree, we all got to go through that experience to realize that that's not it. And it's just yeah. because they're coming from lack. And often we come from lack because we have trauma that we've experienced in our life. You know, when I do my trauma coaching, we work through 10 layers of trauma. And I got to be honest, Hala, so many people, like you'd see them and you think they got their life together. And I get in and like by the time like I'm going through the 10 layers and out of 10, they've got eight. Like they were physically whipped, smacked, beaten when they were a kid. They were told they weren't good enough. They were told they can't show strong emotions like anger or joy. They were shamed by their family or their friends. They were held to a responsibility of their parents' happiness. They were emotionally neglected, right? They felt like they were walking around on eggshells. They felt abandoned. Like there's so mm-hmm. many different levels of trauma. Like when we hear trauma, we think it's just getting hit or like a car crash or something mm-hmm. like that. But it's not. Trauma works on a mental and emotional level too, you know, and a sexual level too. So I think a lot of what we do is if we're coming from needing motivation all the time, we're going to come from force. We need to force it. We're forcing up the hill, forcing all the time, trying to beat the clock. It gets glorified so much in entrepreneurship. You got to like run till your feet fall off and your face melts. And it doesn't impress me because I know it's coming from lack. And if you want to operate in a higher frequency, it's about coming from power. Like true, yeah. authentic power and creation. And the way we do that is we move to a place of forgiveness first, forgiving the things that have happened in our past, reconciling with it in the subconscious mind and meeting with that shadow and working through the inner child and showing yourself, hey, I'm on your own team. And no matter what's happened in the past, we don't have to necessarily forget it. We can accept that it's there and we get to let it go. That's taking power back, right? Mm. And working through that, because a lot of the time when people are dependent on motivation, it's because they're using desire, but a faulty desire. I think desire is great in the sense of passion, but a lot of the time they're using a faulty desire that ends up being that the outcome, if they go at it long enough, is disappointment. Mm. It's the same thing as when I've had this experience, and I know people that have had this experience too. You could have a one night stand. In the morning when you wake up, it's like, maybe I desired it beforehand, but when I wake up in the morning, I don't feel very good about myself or the decision I made, right? It's like a disappointing outlook, because it's like, well, you could ask yourself, what was I trying to really chase? I wanted connection, but I got it short term for a quick hit because of the feels in my body coming from void and lack, you know. Or you may like the person and they don't want to be with you. So then it's like, well, man, I'm really disappointed. And I feel like cheap that I just gave myself away like that, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, whether you're an entrepreneur, like I'm sure everyone can relate where they've done things where they've gone, yeah, I'm not so proud of that because I knew I did it like irrationally or off the cuff. And that's because your actions that are coming from you is coming from the subconscious. And 95% of our thoughts are the same as the day before. We only think 5% new thoughts on average, unless we are being intentional. And so a lot of what we do, we think we're so conscious, but we're not. We're really not. And if you've got invisible anchors that are holding you in the past, and you've got mom and dad issues, and you've got unresolved trauma, and you've got the thing that you've never worked through with that happened with your ex, you better bet a lot of that's driving you into your destiny.
Such powerful stuff. Oh my gosh. I love this conversation. So for some reason, what you're talking about reminds me of my journey in terms of me failing. And a lot of my success has actually been me trying to get revenge. So like, I don't know why this is making me think of this, but yeah. Like I, for example, didn't get my dream. I was supposed to be the next Angie Martinez. I didn't get my dream job at Hot 97. My revenge was, I'm going to start this big website and, you know, run the city anyway, you know. Then I didn't get on MTV and I was like, well, I'm just going to become like, you know, an entrepreneur, whatever it was. Like everything that I ever did, even starting Young and Profiting Podcast, was revenge. I was like, you guys didn't give me something. I'm going to create it on my own. F you, right? So talk to us about why that's not a good place to be to start something new. Or is it? And can you like transform it later on into, because I like to think that I'm not, you know, operating from only a place of motivation. I feel like I am inspired, but it did start with that feeling of revenge. Is that good, bad? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, am I talking to us or am I going to be talking with you on this? Because
either way,
we can go there. It's a coaching session. No, that's totally fine. I'm happy to go there. And I'm going to be honest with you. It's a similar place to me. You know, I got beaten in school. And when I dropped out, my thing was I hit the fork in the road. It was like the victim or the victor. And at the time, I chose what I thought was the victor. And to a degree, it was, because it was all the tools I had. And I went, I'm going to prove you wrong. I didn't get beaten. You watch me. And a lot of it fueled me. And to be honest, it set me up pretty good with the foundations. But I'm sure you can really attest to this too, Ala. It gets exhausting, you know, like it, and it becomes this never ending, like it's never enough, you know, like I'm never good enough. I need to do more. Like, and this is where the perfectionism starts to come in. This is where I call it the obsessive idealist, where forms of procrastination could be that sometimes if you have a really big vision, you're getting ready to get ready. It's like the thing that you know is really going to stretch you. You don't want to step into that really big stretch because you don't want to mess that up because you're hanging so much on it. So you miss out on the really big, amazing things you could be achieving. And then the things that are in front of you that are a bit more attainable, you tend to try and perfect it and you overanalyze it and you go into it so much and get yourself so involved that you actually start to disconnect and lose a sense of why you're doing it in the first place, because you're just trying to measure it now and you're like measuring the numbers and the views and the things like that. Even if you're not vocally sharing with people, oh, these are my numbers and views, it's like you constantly need goals and targets to show you that you're doing good enough, rather than actually going, well, why did I start this in the first place? And how do I actually feel about this, right? So I work a lot with entrepreneurs on procrastination, and I teach them how to reprogram their procrastination. So how to counteract their patterns, because there's 6 procrastination types. Mm-hmm. And entrepreneurs are usually either obsessive idealists. So what I just subscribed to you, shared to you, that was the overcompensationary success. That's what it is, called overcompensationary success. And then the second one is the big shot. You know, somebody that has like really big vision, really big. I don't know if you've ever heard somebody where they just keep sharing these like out of these world ideas, really big, like we're going to make $20 million as well and all these things. And like sometimes you're hearing it, you're like, wow, like, okay, go for it, you know. But they tend to drown themselves out with too much of the talking of things they're going to do, and then they jump from project to project and never finish anything.
Yep.
Right. So this tends to be the thing. And then you've got the overgivers too. They're called the angry altruist. And essentially what they do is they tend to hang so much of their meaning of who they are and their validation on giving so much that they end up giving and giving so much that they end up feeling resentful towards others. But I'm going to tell you what, like, you're secretly resenting yourself in the process because you haven't drawn boundaries and you haven't dished out what you actually feel is fair game. You've given so much expecting a certain result. So this is a big one I find with entrepreneurs. You know, it's like all your meaning comes from being this person that gives everybody something, but, you know, and it affects their relationships too. You know, the way that we show up towards our business, as much as it's not a good idea to treat your relationship like a business, because I think a lot of entrepreneurs make that mistake, it also trickles into our relationships. We start showing up like that in relationships too. It's like, this is what I used to do. I had the I'm not good enough story in the background. I was going from overcompensationary success. I got so many pats on the back. I got, like, when I came to America, you guys love to edify people and really pump people up and, like, really applaud. Australia's a lot more just kind of chill and casual. So, like, it takes a lot to impress someone in Australia. But in America, it was, like, this high. And a lot of its status, it's like, they've achieved this and they've made this much money and they've done this and this and that. And it's like, I'm speaking at events and hearing it all the time. So I'm like, oh, well, all these things must be really great things that I'm doing. You know, built schools and giving back and doing. So I'm like, cool. So then I started to actually convince myself of the hallucination that all my value is coming from what I have and what I do. Right. So it translated in relationships, and I would date dismissive, avoidant women that had those tendencies. And I had anxious attachment tendencies of overcompensationary to please people, please. And so I would end up giving so much of the things, like fancy trips, paying for like everything, expensive stuff, gifts, all these things to try and keep and maintain the relationship, even though it wasn't with the right person. We weren't compatible because I had this like idea, this projection of this potential of this person and me being the potential in that relationship too. And ultimately what happened was I reached a breaking point where I was with the woman I really wanted to be with and it just wasn't working. And I was just stressed to my eyeballs. And I had actually eventually, it led me to sitting down with my mom and my dad and doing a very healing conversation with both of them and working through layers of trauma and forgiveness. And when I looked at the girl that I was with, I looked at her and I just thought to myself, I didn't say this to her. I could say it to her now and she'd be fine with it. But like in myself, I was like, I don't need you anymore. And that's bad, right? Like we shouldn't need someone. You should want someone. But I found myself going, oh my gosh, I was in this. It was almost like I snapped out of it. Like I was on, it was like I was on love drugs for, you know, the 10 months. And then I just looked at it. And I'm like, I wasn't even attracted anymore. It's because I wasn't needing to get that met anymore. I realized I could meet it within myself because I had soothed myself and reconciled within the inner child in me that we're not in the past anymore, that we get to create from where we are, you know? So I find like, this is what happens, Hala, is you have these overcompensationary success. It's because of something that happened back in childhood of like, with either your mom or your dad, this is for anyone that's listening too, where like with one of them or both of them, it was just never enough. And they may have never said to you, oh, you need to achieve more and that's not enough. It's just a story you start to form when you're a child, because when we're first brought into this world, there's two things that we need from our parents. We have the necessities like, you know, water and, you know, like drinks and food. But essentially the two things we want is, the first one is we want attachment, because when we're a kid, we have no reference points. We've got an empty brain and we're like, we need to download a ton of information to actually make sense of the world. So we're looking at mom and dad, like our caregivers, and we're like, okay, I'm feeling emotions in my body right now. And this translation would be a baby would be crying. So then the parent goes, okay, they'll pick the baby up. Now the baby can touch, because that's the second thing it can do. If it can't touch, then it's going to cry. So it touches. And now the baby's feeling the body temperature. It's feeling it's seeing the body language. It's seeing the look in the eyes. And it's learning from you in real time, how do I regulate my emotions? Now, a lot of what they teach in the Western world, actually a lot of countries, they teach like, oh, when the baby's crying, just leave it alone. Like to an extreme, yes. To a degree, you want to have independence, but mostly it's screwing the children up, because the child's trying to learn when it feels feelings. How do I regulate my emotions? It doesn't know how. It needs you to show it how. So when you calm it down and that, it's like, okay, now I can soothe myself. So many people miss this incredible, important stage in their life as a child. And then the second thing that they really need, that you and I needed even when we were children, was to be authentically ourselves. And I find that like those that really crack it in life have gone on this journey of like they've like lost themselves and they've journeyed back to who they authentically are. And they're very powerful people because they're unapologetically who they are. You know, they're not scared to be judged or ridiculed. They've learned how to come from love and not fear. And that's been my practice. And I coach all my students and clients to come into that space, and my other coaches too. It's like do the healing to come to that place, because you know, when we're a child, we take things so personally. The whole world, we feel like, revolves around us, and rightly so, because we need to download the information from it. But it could just literally be mom coming in one day, like angry about work, and you see her in that mood and she says something to you and you're like, that means I'm not good enough. And then you take that with you, you know, and it becomes your story you tell yourself, and it either becomes the reason why you don't step in to go for your dreams, or it becomes the pusher and the motivator to make you overdrive in your dreams. Until, you know, like I really believe that we get to do our most amazing and most powerful work when we're centered in who we are. Because some people will think, well, Joel, don't heal me with that. Don't go into the forgiveness stuff. Don't go into the shadow, because I don't want that to be taken away from me, that I'm coming from void anymore. I'm like, no, you actually become even more powerful because you're centered in who you are. And you are really stepping into more of your potential that God has created you to be from the beginning of you entering this world. It's just that the systems and the belief patterns and that have kind of screwed you up and laid over the top and just confused you. Now we get to go back to who you really are. Mm-hmm. And that's where you get to do your best work.
Amazing, amazing stuff. So I want to go back to your four dimensions of success, which is, you've been like, you know, touching on this the whole time. And I want to talk about values, because I know that's kind of step number one, is really understanding your values. Is there some sort of a methodology that you have that you can walk us through in terms of like really identifying? Because like what you're saying is like, you don't want to be guided by all your trauma, but you need to be guided by something. And I think that's your values. So how do we get there?
Yeah, absolutely. So your values are, this is how I see it. Your values is your compass, your vision. When you map your vision game plan out, it's like you're taking off and you're landing strip for your dreams, right? And then when you look at your values, I want you to go deeper. I'm going to challenge you to do it now. If you're listening, is to write this down. The first, you got two types. The first type of values is vocational values. So vocational meaning like fitness, reading, writing, traveling. It doesn't always end with the ing, but it's like a doing, right? It's a doing type of value, right? And it's like usually hobbies and things you like to fill your day with, okay? So getting clear on like, what are my top three or top four or top five vocational values? Then the other side of the coin is your core values. And your core values may be peace, loyalty. It could be integrity, compassion, joy, creativity, you know, like, and sometimes they feel like they kind of cross over a little bit, and that's okay. You can have that, but it's just really about getting clear on like who I be, which is my core, and what I do is my vocational. So okay, getting clear on those and making decisions more from that place, because when you think about it, Hala, every decision you make is driven by your beliefs and your values. Okay, what I believe to be true, my perception of the world and how I see it. And if somebody came along and said, hey, Joel, do you want to go down the alleyway and shoot up heroin? I know it sounds kind of intense, but to me, it's like, well, that's on my hierarchy of values. It's number 199,999,000, whatever, of me being even interested in that. So in that split second, the word values comes from the word evaluate. In that split second, I'm evaluating to go, is that a yes or a no? Do I want to involve my time in this? Because time's the most important thing. Like right now, seconds are going by. We're never getting this back again. Like money comes and goes, and creation, you can keep creating, but time doesn't, right? So values are really important. A lot of people waste a lot of time filling most of their day without their top values, and then they wonder why they're not actually living a fulfilled life, right? And when you're living in what fulfills you, you're in spirit more, so you're more powerful and more inspired. You don't really need the external energy and motivation to light you up. You're already internally lit from within. And then we look at, remember I said beliefs, that just speaks for itself. You know the importance of beliefs, right? So many people have invisible anchors that are holding them down. And so really working through the belief clearing, the trauma, the shadow work, the inner child, all that stuff, super important. But our habits, which we have next, if you look at this, is really interesting. Your habits are like the energy bolts of action that you take each and every day that inches you closer to success. Mm-hmm. And you're either moving closer to it or further away from it if you're not committing to your habits, right? So if our habits, if our beliefs and our values drive every decision we make, well, guess what? Our habits and our beliefs shape our identity. Because what I believe about the world and about myself to be true, and I keep showing up in it, it actually forges my personality, because how we think, how we act, and how we feel determines our personal reality through our personality. And hey, if you're not getting great opportunities in your life and you feel like you're disconnected, like work through those things, because you're probably creating invisible wedges between you and other people. It's like, if I know somebody's centered in who they are, there's like a power to them. You know, when you walk in the room and you go up and you introduce yourself, and you know more of who you are, and you're not insecure in who you are because you've done the work and you've worked through it. There's this frequency to it where I see that and I'm like, man, I want to give this person an opportunity, or I want to be friends with this person. I think we could deliver great value. And you want to help people like that. People like that, that are like fulfilled and that have that energy, they tend to have a lot of people around them that want to support them and that want to work for them or work with them, right? So that creates a massive win for you. And then we have the last element of the four dimensions of excellence, which is skills. You know, the skills, which is able. And I don't just mean like any old skill. It's what you can either hire or acquire. Okay. Because sometimes, like for me, I don't like accounting, but I'm going to hire someone for the accounting because I want my business to do well. Mm-hmm. So it's like, well, someone's got to manage it. It's not me. It's like the last thing on my ladder too, is write down lowest values. But someone else can crunch those numbers, right? And then we have acquire. Now, I challenge people with this because there's a breakdown, a study, some research around skill development. And it says that in order to go from, this is generally most skill sets, right? Like Photoshop, learning music, learning software, learning hands-on skills and so on, whatever it may be, speaking, copywriting, whatever it is, in order to be able to get to a level of like above average efficacy in your skill set, you want to be able to develop at least 20 hours, okay? Mm-hmm. 20 hours of learning, so cognitively understanding, but also applying and practicing and getting feedback and learning how to fine tune the art, right? So 20 hours. Now, I say this to my students and my clients all the time. I say to them, okay, there was someone that wanted to go for a pay rise in their job. They wanted to get a promotion. I said, define the skill. Which skill is it? And they're like, well, for me, it's actually, it's negotiating, because they wanted to get into a sales position. And it was going to be, it's crazy. Like the jump between their pay brackets was literally like 50 grand a year to like 90 grand. So it was like a 40 grand jump. And I said, okay, if I came along and I said to you, I'm going to give you a $40,000 pay jump this year, year in, year out, and you could even go higher down the line because you have no cap on commissions. Would you commit for just 30 days straight, 40 minutes a day, learning the skill set of negotiation and sales? Would you commit to just 30 days straight to learn that skill set? It's only 20 hours. Like every time I ask somebody like that question, they'll say, of course. Hey, if you could make an extra six figures this year or multiple six figures a year, would you commit to 40 minutes per day for the next 60 days? Would you do that? And remember, you don't lose it. You could take it with you for the rest of your life if you want, and add it on top of it too. And you can train it and you can teach it and everything else, right? So I like to challenge people to think like this. You know, pull it apart. Like I love creating frameworks. I love getting really complex teachings and then like simplifying so I can teach it to the masses and go like, let's compartmentalize this, break it down, make it actionable so you can commit to it. And like, then let's see if your life improves.
Yeah.
I've been testing this stuff for more than a decade and it works.
Yeah, I could tell. And if anybody's interested in that 20 hour rule, I actually interviewed Josh Kaufman, who I think is the one who developed that. Right. And so if you guys want to check that out, just look for Josh Kaufman on my feed. I want to know about self-sabotage, because from my understanding, you believe it doesn't exist. And I think it's a really important lesson to teach everyone. And so I want to make sure that you give that message before we go.
Man, you did some research. You know me well. You know me well. You must have looked at a lot of my content. This is great. Thank you. I appreciate that. I really do. You know, it is refreshing, you know, because it means that we're able to go even deeper on the stuff that is, you know, good work that we can share with your audience. And they're lucky to have you. Seriously, this is great.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, I don't believe it exists. And the reason being is because there are two worlds that exist within us. You got the aware and the unaware, okay? And the question is, like, which part of you is getting what it actually wants? Is it the aware part of you? Is it the unaware part of you, which is the unconscious? Okay. And like I shared before, so much of our traumas and our lack and our scarcity and our voids are coming from the unaware. There's some good things in there too. I don't want to just make it out like the subconscious is responsible for every, you know, like bad thing that's happening in your life. It's not about that. There's some great programs in there too that have worked really well. It's just a matter of like, I want to do even better and I want my people to do better. So it's like, let's look at it and see what can we tweak, what can we improve. And self-sabotage for the most part is when you haven't integrated and brought the unconscious into the conscious. And Carl Jung says this, he says that unless we make the conscious unconscious, it'll direct your life and you will call it fate. Okay. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people are like bouncing around like a pinball in a pinball machine, not bringing any of the unconscious to their awareness. So it's like, you know, if I'm in a situation where, let's say I'm trying to do a business deal and somebody walks in the room and they remind me of my father and I haven't healed. And then I feel like they may be narcissistic. Not that my dad was, I'm just saying that as an example. Mm-hmm. Some people experience that. And then it starts to trigger them. And then they start like looking at that person as a representation, as an avatar of their father. And then they don't know how to connect with it. And then it like they lose a deal. They could get triggered in that moment, their stuff comes up. And they may not consciously be wanting to do that. It's just that it starts to, because your body is the unconscious is the body, you start getting the feelings and you're like, I don't like this. And you become mm-hmm. disempowered. And it's very evident in a room, especially when you got business deals going on, negotiations, or, you know, like people are very attuned to seeing like who's the alpha in the room and who's handling this and who's stepping in with confidence. It happens a lot in the business world. I'm sure you've witnessed mm-hmm. that. So the more that we can work on that, what it means is that your unconscious isn't playing sneaky games anymore. It's like, it's not popping out here in front of you. Like, you know, it's kind of like, you know, let's say like you have a friend that goes to hide behind the corner because they want to scare you and you've already seen them going, you're like, I just saw them try and hide because they're going to jump out and like try and scare me. It's not mm-hmm. scary, is it? Like you walk up and they're like, blah, and you're like, ah, I saw you there. It's the same thing that happens with your unconscious too. So if I'm catching those things out and acknowledging that they're there, I've identified, acknowledged, and then I've let it go and I've healed it and I've reconciled with it, it can't play sneaky games anymore. It's like I've shone the torch on it and gone, ah, gotcha. So it can still be there as like a part of me that I experienced it at some point, but it no longer has power over me. So it lowers the charge in the unconscious, which means that it also lowers the signal it sends to the gut and the body. So then I don't feel like I'm in fight or flight when I'm in those situations anymore. I'm no longer triggered.
I love that. So you brought it up a bunch of times. I want to understand why you believe negotiation is part of like every fabric of life and how we can become better negotiators.
And negotiation is no good if it's not actually taking you towards where you really truly want to go. You know, I say this often to people that especially coaches, they come to me and they're like, yeah, I want to coach and I want to, you know, I've got this money, I've got this budget, I'm going to put it into my branding and marketing. And I'm like, cool, what's your niche? And they're like, oh, and they're not clear. I'm like, well, then you're just going to throw 10 grand or 20 grand up the wall. Like, what's the point? If you're one degree off or a couple of degrees off, and not to be perfectionist about it, it's just that sometimes some people may not have all their ducks lining up in a way which could be really powerful for them, and then they just go on the course in that direction thinking, if I put a bunch of money behind it, it's got to work. And that's not true. It's not the case. I've had people that say, you know, Facebook ads doesn't work. It's like, well, you just haven't, maybe your content sucks.
Yeah, like, you haven't really figured
like,
it
straight
out.
I'm just like, maybe your content sucks. Like, let's look at it and we'll make it better. Like, I'll give you feedback and let's get it to like a better level or a premium level. Maybe they're not convinced that you can actually coach them. Maybe they feel like, maybe they're picking up on unconscious stuff. Maybe you're not ready to be a coach. Doesn't mean that you won't ever be ready. Maybe we've got a little bit more work to do. You know, I'm very honest, because I had to be honest with myself in order for me to actually play at a higher level. I needed that. I needed people to lovingly kick my ass too, you know? So yeah, I think that when it comes to negotiating, it's making sure that we're going in the right direction first. And a lot of your values, beliefs, habits, skills, great frameworks, casting your vision out and making sure you're injecting your values in it so that you're crafting something you actually want to go for, and being real with yourself when you've got healing work to do in yourself too. You know, you get better and better at picking it up. You never fully get it. That's why you need a coach or a mentor. But when it comes to negotiation, this is what I'll say. there's that, making sure you're going, you know, in the right direction. Mm-hmm. The second thing is when you're negotiating, a lot of times people get caught up in the experience and they'll kind of go all over the place. I truly believe that the name of the game is whoever stays in their lane the longest wins. It's actually very straightforward and very simple, and people complicate processes too much. So it comes to negotiation. If I got something that I desire to create, either with that person or something that we're looking at achieving, and I think that they'd be a great support or vice versa, I stay on target. So this is, look, this is what I want, right? Like, you may introduce some other things, we may consider it, but what I really want to be able to create is this. When I reach out to people for like interview requests, you know, we've had a lot of awesome guests like you as well. I'm just very direct. It's like, hey, here's what I'm looking for, and here's what I'm going to bring to the table. Are you down? Like, are you open for this? Like, yes or no? You know, like, mm-hmm. I don't sugarcoat it. I don't want it to be too fluffy. It doesn't need to be. So there's that. When it comes to negotiating in sales, people buy based off feelings. They don't buy based off facts. You can spout the statistics and the numbers and everything. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. They're not going to remember that, really. Like, unless it's a very profound thing and that they're a numbers person, they're probably not going to care for it. Mm. What they remember, like Maya Angelou says, is how they felt when they were around you, how you made them feel. That's what they take with them. Whether they know it or not, they just remember. It's like, if I think of people in my life, and even you, like, think of certain people and think, there's some people that just irk you, like you feel squirmish around them. And then there's some people where you're like, man, I just really love being around that person. So my goal is that I find, like, if I'm sitting there, I know I'm talking quite a bit because I'm also being interviewed. When I'm interviewing people, I'm a lot more quiet. But, you know, when I'm connecting with people in negotiation, I'm often the one asking them questions and listening a lot more to their stories. And I'm also guiding and navigating and directing the conversation by asking them, like, you know, what are some things you'd love to create? Like, share 2 to 3 things. Okay, what are 2 to 3 things that you feel like you're struggling with? How long do you feel like you were struggling with that for? If you were to work with me, what would your next 30 days look like? What would your next 90 days look like? What would a year look like for you? How would you feel if you were able to be supported? So I'm taking them through positive and negative emotional journey. And it's not like NLP-ish, blah, blah, blah. It's that this is the best way to be able to actually connect with someone, like, real to real, and actually like, what are you feeling, bro? What are you feeling, ma'am? Like, mm-hmm. what are we feeling here? I want to get like an idea of what actually lights you up. I want to get an idea of what you feel like is painful and you're struggling with. Otherwise, it's just a bunch of just script talk, you know? So yeah, negotiation for me a lot is digging into people's journey. Like, I have a great fascination and curiosity to want to know people and know their story. And yeah. I get that from you too. You know, mm-hmm. you brought it up in this conversation too. And you go very far in life because it's about getting to know them. And everybody's favorite radio station is WIIFM. It's like, what's in it for me is tattooed on their forehead. Mm-hmm. You know, everyone's about that. So yeah, it's good to know. Good to know that for sure.
I think that's great advice. Okay, so the last question I ask all my guests is, what is your secret to profiting in life?
I give it back to God. Mm. Give it back to Him. Because as much as I like to think that I created absolutely everything, it wouldn't be possible without Him. And I'm not trying to make this like a Grammy speech or an Emmy speech. I truly believe, you know, in my beliefs, in my views, that I'm, you know, we have the opportunity, and I experience the opportunity to co-create with God. I don't see Him as somebody that just predestined my whole life, that He's got everything all mapped out. I think He'd be probably a pretty angry architect by now because I've gone against the plan many times. But I do believe that He's there co-creating, you know, with me in that. And it's very powerful. And I can say that because I've experienced it on many different levels. And I've come to understand that we're not just dancing with our DNA. Like, we didn't just pop out of nothingness. Like, we're here for a reason. You know, when He brought us out of eternity and placed us into the finite, into time, He did that for a reason. There's value in our heart. Your life has meaning, and so does mine. And I never go a day without remembering that and thinking about that. It's really important. You know, we're all really important. And I think the world loses sight of that a lot. Especially now, there's a war on reality. And I think a lot of people are confused about what's up and down and left and right. And then things are politicized and there's, you know, a lot of confusion in the space. And it's like, who do we trust now? And so for me, my big thing is making sure I'm surrounded by great and powerful people, and powerful in the fact that they're coming from the truest power and the most potent power, which is love, you know, and creation. And my spiritual walk is super important for me. And that's where I profit. I don't measure money. Like, yeah, we could say money is profit. ultimately, I want my soul bank to be full. You know, my bank account can have some dollars in it to build some structures, but I want my soul bank to be full. I want to feel like what I said and did left a great impact on somebody, that when they walked away from me, they felt seen, heard, and understood. You know, like that's powerful. That's how I want to feel, and that's how I want others to feel too.
That's beautiful. And where can our listeners go to learn more about you and everything that you do?
Yeah, thank you. You can check me out on Instagram. So I am Joel Brown. We also have the Addicted to Success podcast. I also have another podcast called The Unknown God. And it's a podcast for people that don't like church, right? It's very much about spiritual transcendence. And we go into very theological conversations. We talk about escaping the matrix. We talk about transhumanism. We talk about creation. We talk about the world of good and evil and how to make sense of it. We talk a lot of philosophical things. And I got a really incredible co-host on there, Marcos Torres, this guy's incredible. So anyway, you can check that out. And also go to influentialcoach.com if you are inspired to become a coach yourself. There are a lot of, you know, people out there that will proclaim that they're a coach and they can put a title on there. But truly, being a coach means that you're able to actually have the tool sets and the frameworks, and also know how to hear the things that are behind the things that are being said, and knowing how to listen and have that presence and to be the space with others to be able to facilitate transformation. It's about getting results. It's the only thing that really matters as a coach. So if you want to learn how to do that and how to build a coaching business in an authentic way, not selling yourself out, and really doing it from a place of where you value the craft of coaching the most, and you just really love being able to support others in a healthy and powerful way, then head there and apply, because we've got the program is open, and we kick off in the next couple months. All right, so don't miss out, and just message me if you've got any questions. I'm approachable. I'm not going to bite. You know, so just reach out. Okay.
Awesome. And I highly recommend his stuff, guys. If you're going to go with a coach, you better go with Joel. He is absolutely amazing. So thank you so much for your time. Thank you. Wonderful conversation.
You too, Hala. Thanks a million. I appreciate you.
Thanks for listening to Young and Profiting Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please write us a review or comment on your favorite platform. Nothing makes us happier than reading your reviews. We'd love to hear what you think about the show. And don't forget to share this podcast with your friends, family, and on social media. I always repost, reshare, and support those who support us. You can find me on Instagram at @YapWithHala or LinkedIn. Just search for my name. It's Hala Taha. Big thanks to the Yap team as always. This is Hala signing off.